Okay, so want to print something? Where or how do you get the designs and the files? If you don't want to just download stuff, but instead print your own creations, where would you start with that? That's the type of questions we're going to answer today. Hey, I just want to take this spot to say thank you to all the companies and people who have worked to make 3D printing what it is today by freely sharing their knowledge and helping others succeed without expecting anything in return. That's been something that has always been a part of 3D printing, with the very first designs and mods just being thrown out there for everyone to use and improve on. And it has led to what I think is one of the most helpful and friendly communities you could have. So thank you all for that and keep on sharing. Let's start with my approach to using 3D printers. For testing and show pieces and simpler stuff that somebody else is probably going to have designed somewhere already, the best way to go about that is to look for those designs that have already been shared somewhere. Reinventing the wheel for everything is totally unnecessary. Also, I'm not really good at designing parts that look pretty, but only downloading parts and printing other people's designs, I think, that does get fairly old quickly. So, being able to at least make a few simple designs is something I think everyone should be able to do. And hey, if you end up making something useful, you can go and share that back into the world. So let's start with that. The most popular design sharing sites right now are Makerbot Thingiverse, which has been around the longest. So it's got the most designs on there, but it's also got the most designs on there. And not all of them are super high quality. Also, what's up with showing gambling ads on a site that's popular with school kids? Then there's Automakers Umagine, and that's been around for a while too, and has some useful parts on there. And then the newest one of the bunch, Prusa Printers, obviously run by Prusa. They're working towards being more than just a model sharing site with, for example, a worldwide map of where people have registered to offer printing services, tech support, or have a makerspace that's open to everyone. They're also regularly running design competitions on Prusa printers, with the grand prize for the current one being Prusa's washing machine, the CW1, which is for washing resin prints. It all secures them. And of course, the prize includes the SL1 resin printer itself too. So yeah, they're working towards having a bunch of high quality models available on the site for free. So mentioning paid designs, I think it's fantastic when people decide to share their work for everyone to use for free. But you know, when it's more than just a simple connector plate or something, and the designer is taking time out of their day to make a model for others to use, at some point they've got to make some money, and just relying on a buy me a coffee button rarely makes the time to keep producing more great models worthwhile. So when you see a design that you really like, you know, a few bucks are often well spent. This is a sculpted design by Eastman. It's selling for a few bucks. I've printed it in resin on the SL1. And it's just always a joy to look at. But always keep an eye out for how much of the sticker price is actually going to the artist and how much the platform is sacking. Popular sites right now are My Mini Factory or Cults3D, but many artists also have their own shop set up where they get to keep basically 100% of the revenue they make. One note on other sites where you can get models for free, like GrabCAD for CAD models and other sites for artistic models, is that those models are not always made to be 3D printed. There might be features in there that are too small, some geometry that's too tricky to print, even with support material, or other issues that make it unsuitable for 3D printing. When you grab files from a 3D printing specific site, usually you can expect them to be printable. Something to look for with models from all sharing sites is the conditions under which you can use and modify them. Some designs don't allow use for commercial purposes, like selling the part. With others, if you make modifications to it and then share that modified part again, you have to share it with the same conditions now attached to your modified design. So just look into what you can and can't do with the model you download. So I mentioned G-code, but most models you get will be an STL file or a 3MF, which is basically a zip file with more stuff in it. Your printer doesn't understand STL or 3MF files. Those are the actual 3D model, which is basically just a shell representation of what your part should eventually look like. To turn it into something your printer can work with, it needs to be turned into G-code. And that is literally just a string of commands for the printer to follow in that order. And if everything goes right, by the end, it will have produced that part you wanted. So in order to translate the 3D model in the form of an STL file into G code that the printer can run, we've got a little piece of software called a slicer. More on that and all the settings in there in the next video, but basically everything about the print is decided in the slicer already. How big your part is going to be, what printer and what filament you're using, how thick the part's solid shell is going to be, all that is configured in the slicer. And once you have your G-code, that's all basically set in stone. The reason why I bring that up is because when you look at how you can make your own designs, you just need to look at whether your software can export an STL file or an OBJ, and if it can, you can use that software to create new parts. So what approaches are there to design? Well, actually more like create parts. Let's start with a misconception. You can just 3D scan anything. And yes you can, but the results are often not that great, which is why it has kind of fallen out of favor. There are a couple of approaches to 3D scanning that are quote unquote affordable. Starting with using a camera, taking pictures all around the thing you want to scan, and then using a software like Meshroom to reconstruct a 3D model by having it figure out how different parts of the image move between photos. That works well for things that have like a coarse texture, like rocks or statues or stuff made from wood, but does not work on things that are glossy, like cars, or are just a single color and have only very little detail. But it's free. You probably have a camera that's more than good enough for this in the device you're watching this video on right now, and the software is free too. It's just a shame that Autodesk canceled the free options 123D Catch and Recap. Those are really easy to use. Next, you might see laser line scanners that use a laser to project a line onto your object and an offset webcam to capture that perspective shift. Those are useless. The scans are so poor and just have no detail at all, and they make it super hard to capture certain geometries where, for example, your part occludes the laser line in a way where the camera can't see it anymore. I mean, I just don't see the point of those. And then you can move into like proper 3D scanner territory. I've got this Einscan, which uses technically a webcam too, but it has an actual projector in there. Actually, it's got two cameras. It's got a projector in there that covers your scanned parts in lighting patterns and just gets a more detailed scan of anything you put on this rotating scanning table. It doesn't do super glossy parts though. For resolution, photogrammetry using a camera depends on what the scale of your object is. For something like a lemon or an orange, you're probably going to get a millimeter or two. So it's going to pick up some of the pores with a line laser plus webcam scanner. You're looking at more like 5 millimeters or so, but with an actual scanner like this, it's totally possible to get sub-millimeter details on a scan. Of course, there are still better scanners out there that can do larger parts or give you better accuracy, etc., but they're going to cost you. What you usually need to do with 3D scanned models, though, is to clean them up. That is to remove areas, for example, from the background that you don't need, fill in some gaps, or slice a flat bottom on your part so that it can stick onto a printer's build plate. Some scanning software has that built in, but for both parts that you scanned and for parts that you downloaded or created yourself, you can use software like MeshLab, MeshMixer, or even Blender to modify them. MeshMixer in particular is pretty useful because it's easy enough to use and still capable enough to quickly modify or fuse together different models. I guess we should cover file formats real quick before we move on, because there's two different groups that really serve different purposes. So on the one side, you have STL or OBJ, like we said, that's what you're using for a 3D printer, and that represents the shell of your part split into perfectly flat little triangles. It's the same approach game engines use, and that's a super simple format, and that makes it really easy to exchange files between programs. But as soon as you have any surface that's, you know, curved or rounded, that's going to get split up into little straight triangles. So just like on a camera where you don't have infinite resolution to zoom into, you also have limited resolution on the STL file format. The other format from the engineering world is .step, and that tries to be a perfect representation of all the features in a CAD model, but it's limited to that. It can't handle, let's say, art, you know, for example, where it's sculpted and where it's kind of hard to represent, you know, how that surface is shaped with a mathematical formula. So other software that works on STL is, well, sculpting software like ZBrush, or they're free but obsolete. I don't know if this was made at ZBrush, or they're free or obsolete software Sculptris. And of course, Blender, a free and open source package that does pretty much everything, including sculpting. But of course, general 3D modeling, animation, rendering, and for some reasons, video editing too. It can be a bit too much to take in, but if you want to do 3D artist stuff, it can do it all. Getting a full-on Blender tutorial in here would be way too much for this video, but if you want to get a feel for it, check out Ducky3D or Blender Guru here on YouTube, or Ian Hubert, or CG Matt, or in Default Cube for some more advanced stuff. Blender is a hell of a tool. And then, of course, there is the CAD side of things, which is how I most often create designs. While Blender and tools like that are more geared towards getting things to look about right, CAD really is for getting designs perfectly accurate. And that makes sense for making stuff that needs to fit to other parts or needs to have specific properties, or has to be adaptable with a simple parameter change. CAD model, obviously. So yeah, the most popular option right now is Autodesk's free-to-play Fusion 360, which does everything from solid modeling, surface modeling, rendering, CNC programming, and simulation, you name it. It's free-ish for makers and startups, which is fantastic, but of course, that might change at any time, and we're already seeing features being added and removed from the free option. Usually CAD tools are limited to working on the surface description models step files, but Fusion 360 can also import and work with STL files in a very limited toolset. An alternative, at least for the modeling side, is FreeCAD, an open source software, so no restrictions apply, but I've not always found it to be as efficient to use as a commercial CAD package. I was using SolidWorks and CATIA during university, but those turn into heckin' expensive paid options once you leave the realm of education licenses. Now, if you're more at home programming stuff, then OpenSCAD might be a good tool for you. It's basically a programming language for physical objects, and while I find the idea of that really appealing, it is not for me. I kind of prefer a more visual approach. But again, if you like coding, it might be right down your alley. So I think that should do it for a basic overview for how and where to get parts to print, especially for the software side of things. There are already fantastic tutorials out there for each one. Just to recap real quick, what you need for printing is, in 9 times out of 10, an STL file. There are specialized sites where everyone can share the models made specifically for 3D printing, while other sites still let you grab files that you could print, but they might not be optimized for printing. In either case, check how you're allowed to use the files. If you can't find exactly what you need, you can, and you should, create your models yourself. Scanning parts is a mixed bag, but can sometimes come in useful. More often, you'd use software like Blender to model parts that fall more in the artistic range, while Fusion 360 is a very popular tool for precision and engineering parts. So, that's it for this one. In the next video, we'll look at how you then take those files into a slicer to prepare them for printing. Until then, thank you for watching. Make sure to get subscribed, keep on making, and I will see you later.